So the most recent thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to take some of this algae-laden water from the Caloosahatchee when we get back in January, and I'm going to take a bottle of it, and I'm going to set it on Senator Frist's desk and look him straight in the eye and tell him, we've got to get this water bill up because this is what is happening to our people, and we can't continue to have this happen.
In a town hall meeting in La Belle in December 2005, Florida Senator Bill Nelson expresses his concerns about the Caloosahatchee. The Caloosahatchee is a river in southwest Florida. It stretches for 67 miles from Lake Okeechobee west to the Gulf of Mexico at Fort Myers. The river plays a central role in people's lives and in the industries of the counties and cities through which it flows.
It's of critical importance. It affects our entire quality of life. It affects the condition of the health of our community in terms of our living conditions as well as our economic well-being.
It's very important. It's a vital part of our community. It's we get water out of it for agriculture. We put water into it, overflow.
And, you know, property values have just skyrocketed. So not only is just still, again, a means of transportation to go from the East Coast to the West Coast and fishing, but it's also a nice place to live on if you can afford to live on the river. People enjoy the peacefulness of the river.
Less peaceful, however, are the current discussions about the endangered state of the river. Senator Nelson is certainly not the only person in Florida who's concerned about the state of the Caloosahatchee. Many people are worried and angry. The concerns aggravated when blue algae arose in August 2005 and visualized the bad condition of the river. Blue algae can produce a toxin that kills fish and can cause health problems to people. A lot of the blame is addressed to the South Florida Water Management District. This organization is charged with managing and protecting water resources of the region. In the beginning of 2006, the Water Management District held a public board meeting. According to the district, such public board meetings are held to inform the public about ongoing projects and to give a voice to citizens and local authorities. And they certainly rose their voices.
We can't live in a situation that's killing our fishing industry any more than you can on the lake. We can't live in a situation where there's not clean water for swimming, not food for shorebirds, killing the estuary, killing our real estate industry. I invite you while you're here to drive through the refuge and see what's happened in the last year. It's absolutely tragic. It's time we all work together and focus not on another 15 years of business as usual, but let's not destroy a part of the state that has not yet been destroyed. It's about agriculture, yes, but it's also about tourism, and it's about quality of life in this part of the state.
I think it's good that we've offered this forum for people to come and speak and present their information. Our board is listening to that. We've also been offered this opportunity to present to the public here in Southwest Florida the number of different projects that we have ongoing that we think will help relieve some of the pressures on the river and the lake.
Well, they really put on a good dog and pony show, as we used to call it in the industry, but as far as attacking the problem and coming up with a silver bullet, they admitted that they, today in the presentation, that they had no silver bullet.
It's like a pieces of a puzzle that we're working on to relieve the water quality issues, not only with the Everglades, but Lake Okeechobee itself, and also with our estuaries on both sides, which will include the Caloosahatchee River. Eventually we'll do it, building.
About 11 years ago, a group of worried citizens in southwest Florida originated the CRCA, the Caloosahatchee, a River Citizens Association.
The Caloosahatchee River Citizens Association, we call ourselves a river advocacy group. We do work on a variety of issues, from waterfront access to water quality in the basin. We don't call ourselves an environmental organization, although we do get involved in a few different environmental issues, such as wetlands and stormwater discharges. But we're a river advocacy. We want to enhance the river for use of all people, whether it's canoeing, kayaking, rowing, sailing, whatever kind of boat. We want you out on the river enjoying the river, and we want you to have good quality in the river, too. The problems are great. They're huge. We can't stress and exaggerate enough. The river is dying. For the past 15, 20 years, it's been bombarded with the effects of discharges, new development moving into our watershed, a lot of different forces from a lot of different directions. It is very much in trouble, and we felt very strongly about this, and that's why we nominated the Caloosahatchee River to be one of the top 10 endangered rivers in the entire United States.
And in April 2006, American Rivers indeed took the Caloosahatchee in its list of 10 most endangered rivers in the U.S. The influential aspects that have brought the river in its current state have their origin 120 years ago.
The most critical influences on the river would have to include certainly the dredging that Hamilton Diston did back in the 1880s. He built two barges, a dredge in Kissimmee and a dredge in Cedar Key. The one in Cedar Key came down the coast and up the Caloosahatchee, and in September of 1881, there was a large bell that sounded, just a steam horn, and people came running out of their homes to see what had happened, and it was this incredible monstrosity of a machine shows up in downtown Fort Myers, and that was the dredge that was going to change this region forever. By the early 1900s, we have records in the newspapers about Captain Hendry and others, but Captain Hendry was really one of the people that we know, complaining about the drainage and how much flooding it was creating in these areas to the west of the lake.
The drainage of Hamilton Diston caused this flooding because now, for the first time, the Caloosahatchee was directly attached to Lake Okeechobee by means of a canal. More water ran faster into the Caloosahatchee than it used to. Before this, a chain of separate lakes functioned as a system to slow down the water coming into the river.
Then it would hit from one lake to the next lake to the next lake. You got a lot of water treatment for free. Whereas today, one of the issues that we're dealing with is the fact that this water that leaves, let's say, the chain of lakes in the center of the state comes down Kissimmee River into Lake Okeechobee, and it can be out in the Caloosahatchee and down in the bay, San Carlos Bay area at the estuary, in a fraction of the time, and without any of that retention time and without any of that treatment, natural water treatment. The hurricanes of 1926 and 1928 that hit Moorhaven and Clewiston and that brought forward the flood control issue for this region would be the next two most important impacts. And that's where the Central and South Florida Flood Control District come into being, and the design that was created, that is the design we work with today. That design included the locks on the St. Lucie portion of the river. They included widening and deepening the Caloosahatchee. So the Caloosahatchee went from about 8 to 12 feet in the 30s when the dredging occurred by the Corps of Engineers to the second dredging by the Corps in the 40s and 50s where they deepened it to 25 feet. So that's how the Water Management District today got involved with this whole plan. Somebody had to coordinate and organize that Central and South Florida plan.
So the Water Management District originally got involved in the managing of the river in the 30s and 40s, mainly for flood control. The U.S. Army Corps of Engineers took care of the technical parts. Today, both the Water Management District and the Corps of Engineers are still highly involved in the river matters. Because of the deteriorating condition of the Caloosahatchee, they have to deal with being blamed by many different parties.
The problem is, we have a huge population base here in Lee County, and Lee County contributes $38 million a year to the South Florida Water Management District, and most of that money is used as in public works projects south of the lake to help with irrigation drainage for the sugarcane owners and for the agricultural farmers south of the lake. Where's the benefit to the Lee County residents? We're paying to have the South Florida Water Management District actually destroy our estuaries.
Mr. John Cassani is a scientist specialized in the Caloosahatchee. He's not positive about an upcoming solution for the water quality problems in the river.
My own personal opinion is the problems are very significant. The problems are big enough that they're going to take probably a generational time to fix. Well, the specific problems for the Caloosahatchee, I guess you could kind of condense them into too much water or not enough water. The river's out of the appropriate flow range about 40% of the time. That's a huge amount of the time. So we're not getting enough water in the dry season, which causes violations to the minimum flow rule, and we're getting heavy pulses in the summertime that cause some problems on the other extreme.
A group of people who directly suffer from the bad condition of the river are the fishermen.
There we go. All right, you're looking at the sonar screen now, and you can start to see the various marine life that's down there, and you can see how sporadic it is. That's a little set of bait fish there, and over there there's a single fish, some bait fish around it. Normally in a hole like this, this screen would be just dotted all over the place with marine life down there, but as you can see, it's pretty sporadic right now. Right now, as far as fishing for a living, it's almost impossible. Yeah, the fish populations have been thinned out tremendously. And over the years, as the water from Lake Okeechobee has been coming down the Caloosahatchee River and causing various red tides and different algae blooms of that nature, the tarpon have become less and less because the food that they eat have become less and less also. The entire area is suffering. It's not just fishing in the Caloosahatchee, it's also fishing up Atlas J Pass and fishing up Pine Island Sound have all been affected by the pollutants that are coming down the river and the large quantities of fresh water. And as a result, the fish stocks have been thinned out tremendously.
Different researchers show that the fish population in the river has decreased tremendously indeed. A great deal has been caused by the water releases coming out of Lake Okeechobee.
You have the lake regulation schedule that very significantly affects the functioning of the river system. And it's not just the Water Management District, it's in concert with the Army Corps of Engineers.
The regulation schedule is a crucial factor in the management of the Caloosahatchee. Next to the freshwater releases, the local runoff causes problems in the Caloosahatchee. Local runoff flows into the river via an extensive network of pipes, ditches, and channels. It includes urban stormwater and agricultural runoff. Stormwater is pure rainwater plus anything the rain carries along with it. In urban areas, rain that falls on the roofs of houses or collects on paved areas like driveways, roads and footpaths is carried away through a system of pipes that is separate from the sewerage system. Unlike sewage, stormwater is not treated and goes directly into the river. Agriculture is very important for Southwest Florida. It's a driving force for the economic well-being of the region. Florida's beef cattle industry has sales of more than $450 million a year. Florida is one of the largest citrus suppliers in the world, with sales of about $1 billion a year. The sugar factories offer employment to many people in the region. U.S. Sugar is the largest sugar company in the area. There are thousands of hectares of sugarcane fields. They produce about 10% of all the sugar in America. Agricultural runoff comes from agricultural lands and has introduced high levels of nutrients into the water systems of the Caloosahatchee. This is one of the main causes of blue algae, next to the water releases out of Lake Okeechobee. It has severely degraded aquatic habitats that support fish, birds, and other species.
Need to not spend $44 million a year for taxation without representation.
Taxation without representation. There is a lot of dissatisfaction about the way the Water Management Board has been composed.
We're not consulted before you do the releases, and we think that we need to be involved. Now,
there is no election for this board, and several people feel that taxes are being used for the wrong purposes by the wrong board members.
Our board members, again, are appointed by the governor. They represent different elements of our community. Our community is very diverse and broad-based. You know, that they have to represent different interests.
Basically what it is, it's a stacked deck. The fox watching the chicken coop. You have only one engineer on the whole board that has a background in engineering, Len Lendahl. It just happens to be agricultural engineering. You have two that are public relations experts, and one of those two work for a large development company. How convenient. Oh, by the way, did I tell you that the PR firms work for the sugar industry? Oh, I forgot to tell you that. Also, we have a couple of attorneys. Interesting, their number one clients just happen to be the sugar industry. And we even have a member of the board that is the vice president of a sugar industry. One of the members of the board out of West Palm Beach just happens to be a commodities broker that deals in agriculture. Well, if anybody thinks you're going to see any dramatic changes to the status quo, it won't be until this board is removed.
Of course, the agricultural industries have huge stakes in the policies concerning the runoff. Also, their need for irrigation is dependable on the regulation scheme of the water releases out of Lake Okeechobee. Both matters have to do with water management. And the most efficient means to have influence on this management is through the Water Management District.
Well, one of the very effective ways these particular agricultural interests, as they lobby to the governor, they lobby to have their interest implemented by appointment to a policymaking board. We have the vice president of, I believe, U.S. Sugar, who sits on the South Florida Water Management District Governing Board. They make policy that affects their industry.
I think that's a clear conflict of interest. I think clearly that while Governor Bush has the discretion to make the appointments to the governing board, he certainly has not provided a balance in terms of the representative component of that board that addresses the concerns of people throughout the South Florida Water Management District jurisdictional area. The vice president of U.S. Sugar has no business being on the governing board. He has his own interests, and that's south of the lake.
Yeah, when people talk about the conflict with having a sugar interest on the governing board of directors, what they don't realize is that the reason I was appointed to the governing board was they really have for years tried to have an agricultural representative on the board, because agriculture throughout the 16 counties is an important economic aspect throughout the area of South Florida. And so as an agricultural representative, when governor's office was asking around as to who to appoint and all that, many people, not just from agriculture, recommended my name because I have been involved in governor's commissions in the past, 10 years, all sorts of water advisory commissions, the Lower East Coast Water Supply Committee, Lower West Coast Supply Committee, the Caloosahatchee Advisory Committee, the technical mediation group that came up with the restoration plan for the technical plan for the Everglades. And so people had said that I was an ag representative that had been involved representing agriculture throughout the basins and doing it through consensus-based approaches, with sitting down at a table with environmental folks, with the urban folks, and with agriculture to try to come to the three-pronged solution for what works best in a consensus-based environment.
But at the moment, there is certainly no consensus. Lee County even considers a lawsuit.
A possible lawsuit, yes, in federal court to stop them discharging the excessive polluted water from Lake Okeechobee down the Caloosahatchee River, affecting our estuaries.
That's all well and good, but the experience is when somebody starts suing the federal government, litigation takes a long, long, protracted period.
Most things like that, we don't buck them. There are a very powerful organization, and it's hard to keep them from doing what they want to do.
The district funds many water quality projects. The organization seems to realize that the river is endangered. Board member Malcolm Wade blames the powers of nature.
Currently, we're kind of in a crisis mode because of the hurricanes in the last couple of years. We have an issue with water quality in the lake. The hurricanes have caused the sediment in the bottom of the lake to be totally turned up. The turbidity is awful.
Oh, due to the storms. It's due to the storms. It's due to this. It's due to that. 20 years ago, we had storms, and we did not see the lake churn as it does today.
Not everybody seems to believe that the bad state of the river has been caused by the hurricanes only. Everybody does agree that something has to be done, but the question is what?
Unfortunately, the way the system's set up, the more money you have to lobby, the more resources you have to affect policy, you're going to be more successful in getting what you want. That's the way the system's designed. I'm just hoping the natural system can survive that kind of point of view or that process. So we'll see.
you know, it's all going to be a balancing act over the next 20 or so years, and it all is one ecosystem, you know, in the 16 counties. That's why it was set up the way it was, and I think what you're going to see is that the restoration process is going to be done to restore the whole 16 counties, irregardless of what basin you're in and whatever, and the district's taxes for those different basins is going to be just a pro rata for everyone, and they're going to have to understand they're part of that ecosystem, whether it be the Everglades, an estuary, the Lake Okeechobee. It's all kind of tied in together. And so there may have been some, you know, cause to say taxation without representation on the West Coast in the past, but it certainly isn't going to play out that way in the future.
I think, in my opinion, what should be done first is just basic fundamental reform of water policy in South Florida.
Like?
I think a starting point would be to develop a commission that would very carefully and independently and objectively evaluate these problems so that a particular stakeholder or a particular interest group doesn't overwhelm the policy.
It's very hard to get a watchdog group that doesn't end up getting be more powerful than it needs to be, or in its own mind is more powerful than it needs to be.
It's just the politics of it are so interesting. Somebody politically has to benefit from setting up an objective, independent commission, and again, those that benefit are being influenced by powerful forces in this spectrum of influence on this water resource. So again, you're not completely going to get away from those problems, those socio-political problems. You're not completely going to be able to put those aside and move forward in a way that potentially benefits the entire system and all the user groups. I think it can be done, but it's really going to be tough. It's really going to be tough.
This has been a good old boy network for too many years, and it needs to transform from an appointed board to an elected body.
I think having governing South Florida Water Management District Board, governing board members elected as opposed to appointed would be a good step, a good first step in that direction to basic policy reform.
I think what you need is to separate it out based on population, just like you do in the state legislature, where you'd have representatives from various areas, and they would be elected to represent the specific jurisdictional boundary within the South Florida Water Management District.
Just by sheer electoral numbers, Lee and Charlotte and Collier County would just outweigh anything that Henry County could say. So vote-wise, it wouldn't work.
Should clean water be a political issue? Nobody can get along without clean water. But for some reason, this state of Florida has made it a political issue. Clean water is a political issue.
So should the Water Management District Board be elected? And will every county then be represented according to its paid taxes? Should the river even be subject to political debate? And is it possible to originate a kind of watchdog group? It is hard, if not impossible, to give clear-cut answers to these questions. But the Caloosahatchee has just been declared to be the 7th most endangered river in the entire U.S. The crucial question is now, how to get the river out of the top 10? Otherwise, all other questions will become redundant.
We just have to do it. You know, we just can't wait and think, well, if it'll recover in 2 years, then we don't have to do too much. If it'll recover in 10 years, we have to do more. And I think the pendulum is starting to swing back. I think we're seeing the general public much more concerned about these larger ecosystems, and I'm hoping the pendulum will start swinging back. And that will have an effect on this basic policy reform that I'm suggesting needs to happen. So, but who knows how long and how bad it will have to get. You know.
It may take a very long time. So
our river is dying. Our lake is dying. Something's happening to it. And we can't allow that. We've got to speak up.